Thank you. The life. No one comes to the Father Gospel of the Lord. And when I think of Ken Pondo, who it's been my privilege to know for over 13 years, I am reminded of St. Joseph. And how fitting, perhaps, that it is that Ken has gone into eternity as the Church begins to celebrate this year, the year of St. Joseph. Because, like Ken, St. Joseph was a hard worker. He was a man of deep faith. He was totally dedicated to his family. And he would do anything for anyone who had need of him. I certainly encountered that over the course of my life here. And St. Joseph is the patron saint of a happy death. It almost seems like a contradiction of terms. What is happy about death? Well, think of how St. Joseph died, with our Lord on one side of him and our Lady on the other side of him, his family consoling him as he made that journey from time to eternity. Ken indeed was like St. Joseph in this. He had his loved ones around him, accompanied by Karen and her children, his children. He knew the meaning of happy death. He was fortified by the last sacraments of the Church, and he was ready to make his journey from time to eternity. But unlike St. Joseph, for whom we have no recorded words whatsoever in the Holy Scriptures, Ken did speak his profound last words to his family, and by extension to all of us, when he said, "Keep the faith." And these were not idle words, because as we know, Kennedy was a devout and practicing Roman Catholic. He didn't pick and choose what sacraments he would receive or what doctrines he would believe, like so many Catholics in our time. No, he understood that commitment to Christ and his Church meant to accept in totality the infallible magisterium of the Catholic Church. And Ken put his faith lovingly in the Creed, knowing that it was right and it was true. Like all Christians who profess the Apostles' Creed, Catholics and Protestants alike, we have the final words of that creed, which I'm sure Kent spoke very often in the course of his life. We begin every rosary with the Apostles' Creed, do we not? And the final words of that creed say, "I believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting." My good people, if we believe those words, then death does make sense. And if we really believe those words, we're going to find comfort and consolation when we ponder the awesome meaning of those expressions. They so easily fall off our lips. Communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. But do we really believe that? We don't believe it. There are those who deny these truths, so there are no words we can drum up that are going to give any kind of meaning to death or comfort to those who mourn. So let us examine. I believe in the communion of saints. That means there's an ongoing awareness between the living and the dead. The church is not just the church militant. Looking around us, we see this building filled with faithful Christians, yes. The church militant is part of it. But then there is the church triumphant. Those who stand already in the presence of God, the angels and the saints, our Blessed Lady, St. Joseph, St. John the Baptist, and all those who glory in eternity. And then we lower our sights a bit and we see the communion of saints is also the church suffering, the souls in purgatory. And that is what we come together to do today, to pray for the dead. Well, as the Old Testament says, it is a holy and fitting thing to pray for the dead so that their sins may be forgiven. I know there are Christians who believe that once you die, you're immediately to heaven, immediately to hell. But that is not what Christians have always believed for 2,000 years. We believe that if we die less than perfect, but not enemies of God, we go through a period of purification. We Catholics call that purgatory. And that is why we pray for the dead. Because if the dead are in heaven, there's nothing to pray for. They have everything. If the dead made the tragic choice to separate themselves from God, then even God can't force his love upon them. They are lost by their own choice. And to pray for the damned makes no sense at all. So we come together to pray for the living, knowing that as living, we pray for those in the state of purgatory, that they may soon be liberated. Now I'm sure in our hearts, those of us who knew Ken, knew how faithful he was, that he died with the last sacraments, the apostolic pardon, perhaps he is already in the presence of God. And if he is, he will take the grace of this Requiem Mass and apply it to some poor lost soul who doesn't have this many friends and family to remember them. We know how generous he was. He's going to take that gift and make sure someone benefits from it if he doesn't need it himself. And if perchance Ken, like most of us, had perhaps venial sinner imperfection to atone for, then he is aided by what we do here and now, by the offering of this holy sacrifice of the Mass. And he will soon have the fullness of that beatific vision if he does not already possess it. But my friends, Ken Pondo has a better knowledge and understanding of his family, his friends, his loved ones now than he ever did before. And from his place in eternity, even the souls in purgatory can intercede for their loved ones upon earth. And we know that he's doing that. He's going to spend his eternity doing good for us whom he has left behind. Now, we also believe in the forgiveness of sins. And we know that Ken relied upon the sacrament of penance in his life and the sacrament of extreme unction at the end of that life. So when he closed his eyes in this world and opened them in the next, he fell into the arms of a loving and merciful God. We don't worry about his fate. Maybe we should worry more about our own. Because some of us are making choices from time to time that maybe God does not approve, and he is not pleased with. And so we have to imitate Ken Pondo in putting our trust in the mercy of God and call for the forgiveness of our sins. But we don't worry about him, because he made the right choice right to the final moment of his life. We say we believe in the resurrection of the body. That's why we Catholics show such reverence and respect for the mortal remains. That is not Ken Pondo in that ritual book. But what lies under that veil that represents the baptismal veil is matter that will be glorified at the end of time. That is why on this altar we have the relics of Maria Loretta and St. Peter of Verona, because of their place in heaven, they are focused on their material reality upon earth that will again be their glorified body. And that's why we Catholics honor the relics of the saints. That's why we Catholics honor the body of Saint Pondo, because we believe that what we put in the ground today is like a seed that eventually will sprout and grow in the resurrected body of Saint Pondo. What happened to Jesus on Easter morning? What happened to our Blessed Lady on the day of her Assumption? Is going to happen to Ken. It's going to happen to you and to me if we remain faithful. Because we were not created as angels. I mean, I sometimes walk into fact, some people say in the death of the love, no, we have one more angel in heaven. No, we have one more saint, perhaps. But we are not angels. Angels do not have a body. We do. God made us body and soul as human creatures. And death does a temporary violence to that unity of our body and soul, but God has a way of reversing that balance. That is what we mean when we say we believe in the resurrection of the body, not just Christ's body or Our Lady's body, but your body, my body, the body of Him Pondo that lies here before us, because we believe in the resurrection of the body. He will live again as who He was, but perfected. No limitations of a physical nature. You will be able to embrace and to kiss and to love, because physically Ken will live again at a time and moment to God. And we will see Him as we knew Him here and now, in that very same body will be glorified. And then finally, in the Creed we say, we believe in life everlasting. Heaven and hell. We don't worry about hell in this case. Maybe in our own situation, we should take it more seriously, perhaps. It is a choice that we can make, and God will respect that choice forever, because He is ultimately pro-choice. But what choice are we talking about? The choice of life or death, heaven or hell, sin or grace, and you and I are now involved in making choices. And hopefully, like Ken Pondo, we will make ultimately the right choice to live forever with God in paradise. Because we believe in life everlasting. At the end of time, even purgatory will come to an end, and there will only be eternal reward or eternal punishment. And it will not depend on God's will, it'll depend on ours. We know what God wants. He wants us all His children, to come to life, to come to heaven. Why are there so many of us children of God that are not showing Him that's what we want? He says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Look at the world today. Perhaps look at our own life. Do we always keep the commandments? And there are 10 of them. Are we faithful? I know Ken strove to be faithful. And when he fell down, he gave himself up through the sacrament of penance. You and I must do the same. So that we arrive at that point where we can enter into the presence of God forever. You know, my good people, either everything we believe is true, there is God, there is a heaven, the saints and angels are gathered together around us in paradise. Either all of that is true, in which case Ken Pondo is the most fortunate amongst us, because he no longer needs faith, he sees with his own eyes what is true. Or maybe it's all false. There is no God, there is no heaven, there is no hell, there is no reward of life. Well, my good people, Ken Pondo is still the luckiest person amongst us, because the joke is no longer being paid. Played on him. The atheist will open his eyes to eternity and realize he was wrong. But if we are wrong, we never let us know. And we have every reason to believe that everything we profess is true and real and good. Now we can be certain that as much as Ken Pondo loved Karen and his 5 children, if he were offered the chance to return here to earth for the 10 or 15 years more he could have hoped to live, or to remain where he upon our Lord, our Lady, the angels, the saints, and all of his loved ones with God before him, what choice do you think he'd make? He'd rather stay where he can be of greater benefit to the ones he truly loves. He will spend his time in eternity doing good to all of us, his relatives and his friends. There is one other question perhaps we need to answer. A very profound question, and that is, will Ken Pondo be able to go hunting in heaven? It's a legitimate question. You know, a child who loses a dog or a cat wonders, will I have my dog or cat in heaven? Well, the answer is given by St. Thomas Aquinas, and it's certainly trusted to be teaching us the truth. And that is, St. Thomas will tell us that God will provide for us in eternity everything we need in order to be happy. And if that's a pet dog or a cat, God will give it to us if we need it. And if Ken Pondo needs to go hunting, God will provide the deer and the shotgun. He will give us anything we need in order to be happy forever in his presence. So let me conclude that anyone who's ever really known Ken Pondo can certainly be confident that he has already heard, but very soon we'll hear the words from that votive mass of St. Joseph. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come, share your master's joy.
Thank you. Spirit. We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, God, to the end of our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, in him the hope of blessed resurrection has gone, the cross saddened by the certainty of the having, might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, and the eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing a hymn of your glory, as without end we are praying.
Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you.
Thank you.
Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Peter, Felicity, Revenge, Manhattan.
friends, I realize I'm probably preaching to the choir here, but nevertheless, at this point in the Mass, we do have the reception of Holy Communion, and Holy Communion is reserved for those Catholics who are practicing their faith. So if you are a practicing Catholic, I kindly invite you to come forward at this time to receive the Eucharist. If for whatever reason you cannot receive today, I kindly just ask that you please offer up during this time prayers for the repose of the soul of Ken and for the comfort of his spirit.
Sanctis tuis in eternum, via pius es.
Si iniquitates observabilis domine, domine Christus vive.
Cum sanctis tuis in eternum, via pius es. Cum sanctis tuis in eternum, via pius est.
Thank you. I'm sorry.